Distinguished guests and fellow colleagues, welcome to today's co-event organized by the Kingdom of the Embassy of the Netherlands as well as the Center for Liveable Cities. My name is Nisha and I'm with the Center for Liveable Cities, or CLC. CLC was set up by the Ministry of National Development as well as the Ministry of Environment, Water and Resources to distill, create and share knowledge on liveable and sustainable cities. Today we are very pleased to have with us the Ambassador to the Kingdom of Netherlands, His Excellency Jacques Werner. He will be the guest of honour, and in a short while, he will be giving you the opening address. Before I invite him over, I would just like to give you a little bit of an idea of the format for today's screening. So we will begin with a film screening called Bikes versus Cars, which will basically explore how bikes are powerful tools for change, and at the same time also show how we need both bikes and cars to form complementary parts of a transportation system which requires an entire range of options in order to thrive. After the film screening, there'll be an interactive panel discussion which is titled How Cities Share Street Spaces. After that, we will end off with a reception. So without further ado, I'd like to invite His Excellency on stage to give the opening address.
Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, happy cyclists. I've been looking very much forward to this day for a long time, to have a full hall filled with people who are interested to look closer into the issue of cycling in cities. First and foremost, I'd like to thank our partners in the CLC, and Ko Teng Chai, thank you very much also, you yourself, for being here today, for getting this done, this today's event. We've been looking forward to it, as I said, for a long time, because cycling is in our DNA. When you say the Netherlands, you see green pastures and you see bicycles there, trying to find their way against the wind. The wind in the Netherlands is always against you. And in the background you will find the dikes. Well, that obviously is a cliché, but the bicycle probably is part of the cliché of the Dutch. We've had our own history with cycling. Obviously, one of the challenges is now, today, to see how Singapore is moving on this path of cycling, of sharing the public space between cars, cyclists, and pedestrians. And this is an enormous task, but we were very encouraged with the sustainability blueprint of the Singaporean government that basically says the future of Singapore is a car light and a bicycle-rich city. For us, this was the signal for the Netherlands. Let's come and start a dialogue on cycling in Singapore. And this is why we're here today. We have a number of Dutch companies, each from their own angle, working with cycling already for a long time, and trying to contribute to the dialogue that we're starting today. So I'm not saying that the Dutch bicycle cycling history is cut and paste ready for Singapore. No, I think every city, every country has its own cycling history and has to shape its own cycling future. But we can help by telling a little bit about our own experiences and by contributing in a smart way to possible solutions here. Basically, by this event today, we are saying to Singapore, we, the Netherlands, are at your disposal for dialogue, and let's see what happens, what comes out of it. Cycling has many, many angles. Obviously, it can be recreational, as much of the cycling in Singapore is today. Actually, I know cycling rather from, not from recreation, but rather from cycling to school, from home to school and from home to work. For your information, next week I will be in the Netherlands for a few days. I will go to my head office, which is in The Hague, and I will cycle from my house in The Hague to headquarters, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in The Hague. Why? Because it's the most convenient, quickest way of getting there, and because I know, this is what I know. I know no different. There are other angles to cycling. Obviously, health, fitness. There is the element of the clean air, sustainability. There is the element of mobility, of helping to make the city lighter, also as far as cars and other vehicles are concerned. But there's also a downside to cycling. It's also dangerous. You know, we all have to know how cars and bicycles and pedestrians behave in traffic. And so we have to strike a new social contract among the road users. And this is also an important element to take on board. So without further ado, I'd like to present to you this film. It's a long film, but I know that you will only want it to be even longer. It will not be a boring film, it will be a very interesting film, and you will be fascinated until the end. So let's do that now and join the film, and we look forward to our future dialogue and cooperation. And thanks again to also the all the Singaporean institutions and our Dutch guests for being here today, and obviously the happy cyclists of Singapore's future. Thank you very much.
We've come to the second part of the session today. We're going to have a sharing session. And we have with us here in the audience a Dutch delegation. They're on a fact-finding mission. They're here to identify stakeholders, get some insights, as well as map some challenges to the cycling issues over here. And we also have some local panelists who will be joining them. And these are people who are passionate and knowledgeable about cycling. So before I invite everyone down to stage, maybe I'll just tell you a little bit about them, do a quick intro. We have Jeroen, he's a consultant from APPM, and he has three bicycles for different purposes. We have Leihua next, she's the deputy director, she's from the Active Mobility Unit of the Land Transport Authority, and she has the noble task of promoting active mobility together with Kaping, who is another panelist. And then we have Robert. Robert is a commercial director from Pond Bicycle Group Asia. He's a global citizen of sorts, and he cycled everywhere that he has lived in. And then we have Francis. Francis is the co-founder of LoveCycling SG, and I hear that he took our Dutch counterparts on a crazy cycling trip this morning. I hope you guys had fun. And we have Joziene. Joziene is the managing director of Heijmans Technology, and she is in the line of turning streets into light shows. After that, we have Kaping. Kaping is the senior director of the Urban Planning Excellence Department, and he is also a longtime friend of the Netherlands royal family. And last but not least, we have Martijn. Martijn is the head of the Urban Mobility Group from Witteveen+Bos. He's also a traffic and transportation expert. We will have moderators from both agencies. We have got Dr. Limin He. She is the Director of Research at the Center for Liveable Cities. And then we also have Ms. Susan van Boxtel. She's the Innovation Advisor from the Netherlands Office for Science and Technology at the Embassy. They are spirited in their own way. Limin actively commutes to work on an electric kick scooter and a bicycle, and Susan rides a motorcycle. Now, the discussion today will have the panelists taking turns to share their experiences. And there will also be a final question and answer session in the last 20 minutes. Now, during the Q&A, all you have to do is just raise your hand, and then one of us will come to you with a mic. And there will be tokens of appreciation for asking questions as well as for staying till the end. And don't forget that we do have a networking reception at the end of it. So without further ado, I'd like to invite our panelists and moderators to come down on stage. And Limin and Susan, the floor is yours now.
Okay, so today we have we are super fortunate to have seven specialist experts in our panel, three from Singapore and four from the Netherlands. And on their daily job or passion for Francis, they are working on active mobility in many cities all over the world. I hope you all enjoyed the movie. At least I did. I saw it for the third time today, and every time it is very fascinating what I see. Especially in the beginning when we see so many good examples and bad examples in a way from traffic heavy cities such as the Los Angeles and Sao Paulo. We see people on their daily commutes, both cyclists and also drivers. I think the taxi uncle from Copenhagen is excellent. So we see stories from the past, and I think most of those cities have in common that they were cyclist cities a long time ago. We see present situations, which are all very different all over the world, and we see a little bit of a view into the future. And we all see that these cities all cope with the same challenge of sharing space for all these different ways of transportation.
Yes, thank you, Susan, and a warm welcome to all of you to our discussion. Just to give a little background also, the Center for Livable Cities has been doing this research with the Urban Land Institute, which is based in the US, on creating healthy places through active mobility. And we have been working with many of the agencies as well as experts from Copenhagen and this time, you know, from the Netherlands. And we do hope that we continue in this push to have an active culture of active mobility in Singapore. Today we are, of course, very happy to have the experts from the Netherlands as well as our wonderful friends from our agencies, LTA and URA, and also Francis, who is himself has a big constituency of cyclists in Singapore. So I hand it to Susan to start today's discussion.
Okay, so the discussion I think will be very excellent. Of course, we will start with a few small questions to the panelists. But after that, definitely the audience will have to ask the questions. So shall we start with Jeroen and Kaping, Limin?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
Jeroen and Kaping, perhaps you could share with us some of the efforts that you have been making in developing a thriving culture of active mobility in the cities that you work with. Maybe starting with Kaping.
So although the film Bike versus Car put it very starkly as such, but actually the fundamental issue is about how do we manage and meet the needs of transportation in the city, and what's the role of cycling in that system, in the transportation system. In Singapore, cycling mode share is around 1 to 2%, which is quite similar to other large cities like London and New York. And we are nowhere near, the mode share of 25% in Amsterdam and Copenhagen. The way we see it, how then does cycling play in this transportation system? The public transportation system, mode share now, when I say public transportation, I mean the rail, the buses, including the taxi, is around 60% now, and we intend to move that to 75% in 2030. And we realize that it's not possible to keep on expanding or widening the road network because we just don't have the space. So what then can we do to encourage or to make cycling a viable option for commuting? Okay. So there are two aspects of this. One is the infrastructure side. The other one is the software side. So on the infrastructure side, from just some background, cycling used to be quite a popular mode of transport, just like in some of the other cities. We used to cycle to school, when we were young. But at a certain point, I think from the 70s onwards, cycling suddenly became not very popular. Okay, and then cycling got revived again because of the park connector system. We have this park connector system that connect parks to park. And so that was started in 1990 as a major idea, as one of the major ideas, one of the big ideas in the 1991 concept plan. And MParks started to implement the park connector system. So right now, I think we're around 250 to 300 km of park connector network in Singapore. And that encourage cycling, firstly, as a recreational option. People use it for recreation. And what we intend to do, I don't know whether we can copy some of the slides. Yeah, so this is the park connector system connecting park to park. And we are also going to build 150 km long around the island route, shown in red. So if we go to, can you show the slide on the National Cycling Plan? So this is the National Cycling Plan, which was unveiled in the 2014 Master Plan. This was developed jointly with all the other agencies, like LTA, MParks, HDB. What we intend to do, the red circles are those intra-town bicycling network within the towns. And we also intend to have some of these inter-town routes to connect the towns. Now, cycling, the way we see it, it is possible to make it attractive because in some of the towns, the kind of trips that are made, 50%, 30 to 50% of the trips are short trips, about 5 km or less than 5 km. So it's possible to make some of these trips instead of using cars, buses, it's possible to make some of these trips using bicycle, okay? Using cycling. So how do we do that? So infrastructure is very important. Legally, you can cycle on the roads, okay? On the road. You're supposed to cycle on the road legally. But as you know, with the amount of cars, with the amount of buses, it's not safe, okay? So in the last 10, 15 years, LTA, MParks, and the town council, they have built up the cycling network in a few towns, Pasir Ris, Tampines, Sembawang, okay? And in fact, the cycling culture is very active in those towns, okay? So then what do we do to make cycling even more popular? And we undertook exercise, looking at Amokyo, using Amokyo as a model, how can we look at it, in terms of the infrastructure? When I say the infrastructure, it includes the tracks, includes how we see the crossing, include how we see the other complementary facilities like bicycle parks, signages, so as to make cycling, the way you see cycling is make it convenient, comfortable to use, safe to use, as well as a delight to use. Okay, these are very four important criteria when we look at cycling. So this is the network in the Amokyo town. This is a mature estate. Okay, there's not much cycling infrastructure here, so that gives us the opportunity to try something new. Okay, something that we can think comprehensively and right from the start what we think should be the kind of network that we want. Okay. So Amokyo, we have two MRT stations and there will be two more being built and altogether four MRT stations. So the cycling network to be convenient should be connecting to the MRT stations, connecting to the major, the town center, the neighborhood center, to the schools, to the institution, so and so forth, so that it's easy to use within the town, to the places of work. There are some factories over there. Okay, so that's this show the MRT station next. So when we look at the cycling network, we propose, this is something that we learned from Copenhagen, in terms of gradation or speed, cars very fast, cycling next fastest, and then pedestrians. So we propose to put cycling closer to carriageway. After that, we have the pedestrian nearer to the next to the estate. So when you come down from the estates, the steps and all that, you don't straight away meet the cycling. You meet the footpath first. After that, you want to cross the road, then you go over the cycling. Okay. So that's what we envisage. And from in this exercise, we conducted several focus group discussion, and Francis was also part of the focus group. This is very important because it is not meant to be top-down. We want it to be bottom-up. So we have focus groups, a number of focus groups that we conduct with the cycling enthusiasts, community, the residents, to find out exactly what they want. And in fact, for Amokyo, we did an exhibition beginning of this year in the Amokyo, the public square there, to actually get the feedback from the residents. And one of the feedback that they gave to us is that they prefer to have segregated cycling track from the pedestrian path. Okay. The next slide. Yeah. So these are the details that, you know, whether, you know, when you look at crossing, and this is the process of being, finalized. This is a crossing. Next. This is about how we can reclaim space from the road. These are smaller streets, quite wide, the carriageway. There's potential to narrow it down and to create a cycling path. Okay, so, yeah, next. This is something that I didn't know Pasadena have this elevated cycling track that runs for a kilometer. We have something like this running behind the MRT station, crossover Ang Mo Kio Avenue 3, and then land on the deck under the MRT viaduct. So these are the things that we are looking at to make cycling safe, seamless, so that we will encourage more people to use it. Now it's very important to encourage this. The other aspect, beside the infrastructure, is the software part. By software, I mean education. You know, how do you educate the motorists, the cyclists, and the pedestrian? Because as I mentioned in the background, there's a generation that they have never really seen that kind of pervasive cycling they used to see. You know, so motorists do not know how to react to cyclists. Cyclists do not know how to behave towards pedestrians. So there's a need to, to educate them on how to treat. You see, when you are a cyclist, when you cycle, and then when you drive, you tend to be more sympathetic to the cyclist. You know, that is a kind of behavior change. And the other thing that we need to, as part of the software partner, is about what kind of tone of enforcement do you use? Because how do you change behavior? Okay, and very important, it's very important, you need a champion. And now we have LTA as a champion, because LTA is in charge of active mobility. Okay.
Thanks, Kaofeng and Jeroen.
So first of all, thank you for having me here. It's very interesting to have a discussion with you on this amazing topic. Let me introduce the efforts we do at APPM with cycling in just four pictures. Because the four efforts we take. First one is actually policy making and reviewing. This is a typical street layout in Amsterdam, where you see segregated lanes for bicyclists, pedestrians, motorcyclists, and even trams. Usually buses use the tram lanes as well. So this is a result of a profound policy. And we have over 20 years of experience in making policy and reviewing it, so we can help a lot of cities with it, and we did so in Berlin and in Miami and in Denver and a couple of other cities. The next one is what we call planning the cycling city. It actually consists of two main points. First, a shift to a network paradigm. So it's not just projects executed solely, but you have to think for mobility in the whole network, which also means that you make good bicycle sheds near stations. This is the bicycle shed of Utrecht Central Station in Holland. It's very modern and it works greatly. And we call this hybrid. We call this hybrid orientated development. So it's not just one mode of transport which you should promote, but you try to intertwine the different modes of transport. The third picture is the way we try to make tailor-made solutions for different cities. We usually do it in a workshop with local people, because local people know the best the local circumstances, so you should do it together. So don't make a template, but take every city on its own and make tailor-made solutions. And then the fourth effort we take is trying to influence behavior, because a lot of people just are in love with their car and they don't even consider taking a bike. So it needs campaigning, it needs making cycling hip, and it needs some psychology to get people on bikes, and we have done different projects to do so. And this one is called B Riders. I can explain to you more about that later, maybe.
Thanks, Jeroen.
I thought from the movie what I saw and what we all noticed is that a lot of people said that these cities are designed for cars and not for people. And I think, to me, it sounds very obvious that that needs to change. So I think the question is for Martijn and Joziene, how can we design cities for people, and what kind of innovative cycling initiatives have you been involved in? I know you have been, but maybe you can share a little bit there.
Yes, I can, of course. Well, let me start with this movie we've seen, because it was quite shocking to me sometimes, and it felt like it's a privilege to live in the Netherlands where all those things, yeah, are not happening. It's just, I can cycle to work, it's ideal. So it was quite a shock to me to see this movie. And I have 4 bicycles, by the way, but that's now. But I'm also a car user, and I'm also having a public transport card. So I have a freedom of choice for transportation, and I think that's what we saw in this movie. They are lacking a freedom of choice. They are stuck to the car or have to take public transport or whatever. We have freedom. Maybe we can have a slide? Well, one of the innovative projects I've worked on was planning a cycle network for a city of Oslo in Norway. Maybe it's not so innovative, but the process is very innovative. It was a cycling community that attracted a lot of funds to organize a prize competition and to get, well, bright ideas to simulate cycling in Oslo. And we won our prize for developing a very practical network, which probably can be implemented in a few years. Next one. Other thing I'm doing quite often is working on studying the origin destination patterns in the city. Because we can build cycle paths everywhere, but if we want to have them used by the right people and build them for the right purpose, we should really study where are people living, where are they traveling to, what's the distance, what kind of competition from car and public transport do we have, and how can we develop a very good network. That's basically the part, or the start of getting a good network. And another thing you could see, but it's already gone, was I worked in the city of Amsterdam for the traffic light unit in programming cycle-friendly traffic lights. I worked there for approximately 3 years. This is a project in Almaty in Kazakhstan I worked on the last 2 years. And it's about getting state-of-the-art design, or Dutch-based design, into Kazakh city. Where you could see on the left, it was really an intersection which was like a Wild West. And to get cyclists in, we really designed it to a very safe and comfortable solution. Well, I think, and again, as we already said, involving the local cyclists. That's what we've done with Yelena, this lady you see here. Involving getting their right ideas. Well, Jeroen also put in a picture of a bicycle parking. I've done it as well. This is also one of the services as a company you are offering, and I put it in my presentation because that's the challenge we have in the Netherlands at the moment. In this whole movie, I didn't see a bicycle park, to be honest. But maybe that's because it was not meant to show bicycle parks, but this is the challenge we have in the Netherlands, where to store all those bikes. This is an example in Haarlem we worked on. And I think last but not least, of course, the famous Hoeven ring. I hope many people, many of you have seen this picture before, a cycle bridge in Eindhoven in the Netherlands. We worked on this together with IPV Delft, which is an architectural company. We were their structural engineers. And it's remarkable because you can see the cyclist doesn't have a very steep slope to get up. It's all very smooth, so it's easy to cycle. And of course, it looks brilliant. And we are, of course, are also studying together with Jeroen consultants to get the team. I wouldn't say copy paste this in Singapore, but get this, all the bright ideas we had for this project to get that more towards Singapore. But cycling bridges is one. You go up 5 meters. A tunnel you see on the other side, which I use on a daily basis, I go down only 2.5 meters. So it's much easier for a cyclist if you can go a little bit down or steep up. That's why I put in the last one. And then I will give it for more innovative solutions to my neighbor.
Thank you. answering a question on infrastructure, I'm from a Dutch construction company, and in discussions like this, I think we tend to talk a lot about mode sharing, about percentages, about infrastructure. But what it really comes down to, I think, is quality of life. The whole movie we just saw, everything is about quality of life. Do you want to live in a city where it's constantly honking of cars, where we have a lot of air pollution? I think with growing middle classes, we do not want. People who have more choices, they start thinking about how they want their children to grow up in a healthy environment, in a safe environment. And so it's about quality of life. And I think Singapore is one of the first cities in the world who has noticed that building on quality of life is building a quality city where people come to and want to invest in. And it attracts people with, it attracts companies, it attracts people, it attracts tourists. So that's where we are really at, not only in the Netherlands, what would be our next step, but also I think in Singapore. And what I think is so very interesting, and that's which is my field of work, is with all these new technologies coming in, we can use those technologies in infrastructure. Everybody's talking about Silicon Valley and new materials, but when you look at infrastructure, we're still looking at asphalt, concrete, and everything. But we're at Heijmans, and that's really my passion, is to show that people that you can use these technologies to make, for instance, infrastructure more flexible. Maybe from change from a car lane to a bike lane on demand. Make more different lighting system which use less energy, but also maybe that's on the next slide. This is our glowing lines where we use less energy and also make the road a little bit safer. Other examples are of making the road and public space a little bit more beautiful. We just did a Van Gogh bicycle path last year in the Netherlands, and it attracts a huge amount of people and from all over the world. And there's a lot of, research on investing in cycling infrastructure is actually the best investment in infrastructure in general you can make. Within 3 to 5 years, you earn back your money. Which investment is so good in infrastructure? I don't know any other example. So investing in infrastructure, in cycling infrastructure, I think is a really good investment. And there are a lot of new smart technologies you can use. Singapore is a very smart city, and I think is ready to take the next step. Then I want to show our last innovation. It's called Bike Scout, where we use real-time data on cyclists and on cars. You were just talking about how to make crossing safer. Mm. Here we have a warning system. We just implemented in an intersection near our own head office, where you warn cyclists only if there is a car or the other way around, that there's a car coming or a cyclist is coming, even with an app in your car, and it shows you how fast you can drive. So we are really all about using all these new technologies and implementing them to make the city not only more accessible, but actually make living in a city more attractive.
Thanks, Joziene. Your slide reminded me about the taxi driver who described the cyclists in Copenhagen as insects swarming around him, and hopefully systems like yours would make driving and cycling safer in cities where bicycles begin to become a majority. Over to you, Susan.
Okay, I think for the last set of questions, we have three more panelists here who are eager to share their vision on using the roads. I think sharing the streets is a very important topic as well. So, Lewa, Robert, and Francis, how do you think, what are your ideas about creating a safe and inclusive culture for sharing the streets?
Well, first of all, I also would like to thank you for having me here. The movie was very impressive. Especially for me, who is from the Netherlands and particularly from Amsterdam, the cycling capital of the world. And yeah, that's a country, the Netherlands, where we have over 18 million bicycles and only 16 million people. So that's 1.2 bicycle per person. And and I work for a big bicycle company, but my moves have been quite interesting because I moved from the cycling capital to Toronto. So I lived for 2 years in Toronto where they were removing cycling lanes instead of creating them. And about a year ago, I moved to Hong Kong. And I don't know if anyone knows how the cycling culture is in Hong Kong. That's even worse than in Toronto. So for me, it's been quite frustrating that since I live there, I haven't been on a bike, mainly due to the fact that cyclists do not count in Hong Kong, and there's simply not enough space on the road for them. And you see that the government perceives cyclists as kind of a pain in the eye or a sting in the eye, instead of that they are really pushing it. And to come back to your question, the thing is making the space or creating the space on the roads and adding dedicated cycling lanes, as you've seen at the end in Sao Paulo, is something which is I think step one, but also to make sure that the cyclists are getting a voice and especially making sure that they count in traffic, but also if something goes wrong that they have that it is a representative of within the traffic situation. And I think that those two matters are very important to take place in order to improve the cycling culture.
Okay, on the topic of sharing space, I think that's really very important because like what Kapping was earlier sharing on putting more infrastructure in to increase the bike lanes and all that, while we are trying to do that, at the same time, we also have to be aware of the space constraints. So at certain areas, definitely there will be a need for different users to share the same space. So what we want to promote really is to have a set of guidelines so that when it comes to sharing spaces, the various users really know how to behave and how to treat each other. So what we've done on this front is to actually start off a public consultation exercise, which is an online exercise for a month, and it's just concluded, where we solicit the public's feedback on how they see the sharing of footpaths for cycling and also for pedestrians. And increasingly, there's been we see on the streets the electric scooters, the electric bikes. So that's also another area which we need to look at. And through this public consultation exercise, we want to actually come to some consensus on the different code of conduct and rules that we should apply to the safe sharing of these spaces. So that's one thing that we're looking at. The second thing is about cyclist education. So on that front, we're actually coming up with a national cyclist education program together with the Road Safety Council. And so what we intend to do with that is to inculcate the cycling skills, as well as let people know a little bit more about all the cycling infrastructure we have, like the dedicated paths, the crossings, how you should be behaving and looking out for the various uses. And also, lastly, to promote the code of conduct that we will develop from the public consultation exercise. And the third thing is that we really want to encourage a community-based approach so that it's not all top-down, like what Kapping was highlighting. So in this instance, the Tampines town is a very good example where it is really the community, the grassroots, that came together to actually want to make Tampines into a cycling town. And what they did was really to take ownership and then come up with their own community wardens to really ensure that there is safe cycling of the footpaths, of safe cycling within the footpaths. So today in Singapore, Tampines is the only place where it is legal for you to cycle on the footpath. That's because they've actually done a lot of education and a lot of community engagement. So we hope that the communities actually will develop in that way and then self-promote all these safe cycling cultures. So with all these measures in mind, we hope that the sharing of the streets will make it safe for people of all shapes and sizes. Yeah.
I'm Francis from Love Cycling. Together with my buddy Taiwan. Taiwan, are you? Where are you? Xiao. just now the picture, actually Taiwan was in the meeting about the cycling code. Yes. In the Love Cycling community, we start very simple, having a Sunday morning ride to enjoy our neighborhood. Just pretend we are tourists of our own backyard. And this caught on over the years, and it became a consistent, enjoyable Sunday morning for a lot of cyclists in Singapore. And when we are enjoying our own ride, we also start to discover there are places that people using bicycle face challenges. And at the same time, when you see the challenges, you already can come up with some sort of solutions. And I really feel that it is very, very important for anybody want to improve the cycling infrastructure, want to make cycling more pervasive among the people. You and they themselves actually tried cycling in Singapore in small way, can be leisure, can be any distance. But once you are on a bicycle, it's a totally different perspective. And our Dutch friend can actually validate that, because today I bring them on a kind of a Sunday ride, but today is the Thursday. But what we do, as Taiwan say, ERP. E for eating, right, and then R for right, and then a P for photo. So that's what we do every Sunday. And we do exactly the same thing this morning. How was it?
Fantastic.
Yes, so basically they have also seen some challenges on road and also enjoyed some of the park connectors as well as Singapore River and some neighborhood area. And in that way, you automatically align yourself with the issues that cyclists are facing. And from everybody's own perspective and professional, and everybody can play a part in how in thinking about how to improve it. And I think there's no single solution, but there are many different approaches.
Yeah. I think that's a really nice way to round up the discussion. I remember in the movie, the last few words were, "This is not a war, this is a city." And I think that's a really good way to summarize the message that the movie was trying to promote. And to round off today's discussion, maybe each of the panelists can say in just one sentence or one word what you think we have to do to prepare for the future of shared space and future mobility in the city.
Okay, that's a short question, but short answer. Okay, we should plan the city intertwining all modes of transport. That's in short what has to be done, I guess.
I hope that with greater promotion and engagement with the community, we can have a better safe cycling and sharing culture.
Further develop the connection between the PCNs.
I would say if you have not started cycling, start cycling. If you are already cycling, keep cycling. How many of you are from Love Cycling today here? Thank you for coming.
I would say in the sense of the movie, it's not cyclists against cars, but just explain to a car user that every time somebody else gets on a bike, that's more space for them. So actually helping people to get on a bike makes that there's more space within a city already.
Basically, I think if you look at the whole ecosystem, if somehow, you know, the technology can make this challenge in terms of car sharing, automated vehicles, and we can manage the number of cars, hopefully we can have more space for bicycles.
Well, I think we saw this bikes versus cars. Of course, we should not do that. But as cyclists, we should behave the best we can. That may sound strange, but we should not give arguments to all those car drivers that we are cyclists are behaving very bad. If we show the right approach, show the right attitude, more will follow, and you have a, yeah, you can have a discussion together. I think that's what we should do in the city. So the city is for all of us.
So these are all excellent comments, and I think now the audience is very eager to challenge you with very cool questions. So we have, of course, 150 hands in the air. We have two guys running, Guru and Kaitek. I see one right in the middle. The one first, yeah.
Maybe we can take three questions at a time to save time, and so we will collect three questions and then we'll answer
okay.
them.
Thank you, Limin. First of all, I want to publicly acknowledge the good work initiated by URA in starting the National Cycling Plan. I remember very vividly that it was a lot of hard work initially. You developed it to a point where you were also good to co-opt LTA. LTA, not many people know, actually started the active mobility unit only a couple of months back. I believe less than 6 months ago. So that's a big move as a user, as a cyclist. So in other words, LTA now has a unit that eats, sleeps, cycles, and dreams about mobility. Okay, so so congratulations to the two agencies to work very closely together. As a user, I have two wishes beyond this National Cycling Plan. We've got many things going very good going for us. The two things I hope. One is that co-opting the education, meaning kids at school. I think cycling is, you know, should be made a life skill, very much like swimming. I grew up cycling to school. It's natural. It's like air I breathe, you know. I don't have to. So the kids today, there are many kids that don't cycle. They don't know how to breathe. I'm very surprised, okay? So cycling as an agenda should be extended to Ministry of Education. And the earlier, the better. I don't think you need a checkpoint to say, I am ready. You are never ready. Any day is a good day, and I think you have to start early. That's point one. Point two is regarding back to LTA and trains. Today, if you look at trains, our trains are already excellent. In terms of service, they're excellent when it doesn't break down, of course. But when it comes to parking next to trains and so on, there seems to be a disjoint. The ownership is not on SMRT. And I think if you can get co-op SMRT to say, look, this platform, this parking, are actually people parking there are actually your customers. Why don't you make the parking sleek, good, working all the time. Make it sexy to drive to the train station, park, and safe. Of course, your bike won't get stolen, right? If you make all that, then rightfully, your users can then maximize those trains, and then it's very pleasant to support the last mile or the first mile. Thank you very much.
Does he get a bicycle? Kitik, is he going to get a bicycle?
Sorry?
Get a bicycle. Okay, the next question is...
This yes, reminds yes. me, by the way, that we would like you to pose your question, a very short question.
Yes, if you can. and also to introduce yourself before you ask the question.
Yeah. Although the compliments are, of course, very much welcome, I would say.
It's a tiny one, it's real. It's real, but it's tiny.
Okay, I'm Joycelyn. I'm from the URA, so full declaration, I work on this project. I remember that when we were trying to get funds from some people in positions of power for our cycling project, some of them were quite skeptical, and one person in particular, you know, when I said that, hey, there's no reason why Singapore, why cycling can't work in Singapore, look at Amsterdam and Copenhagen and all that, and then he like sneered at me, and he was like, huh, those are people in, what do you call it, European climates, and you know, European climates are so much more suitable to cycling. Essentially, who is going to do it in Singapore? It's hot and sweaty, professionals need to get to work, and not everyone has the time to shower, so on. And that kind of haunted me, and I wanted to know what our European friends think about the topic. Yeah, thanks very much.
Okay, one more question.
Okay, so my name is Pina Marciliano, and I'm at the Nanyang Technological University, and I think a few years ago there was a call for from LTA on a share bike system, and I was just curious to know if there was any people who took up on creating that system, and if there's any news or updates on that. Thank you.
So just a summary, one question about bike share, one question about to our Dutch experts about how do you find our climate for cycling, and Jo Kwang is not really asking questions, so yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay, who wants to answer first?
Maybe I can answer. Yeah, may I? Well, maybe to answer your question about the climate, of course. Well, the lucky thing for me was I already cycled in Thailand a couple of times, so I knew about climate. But also today when I came, I kind of noticed that some of us Singaporeans or embassy employees who are not cycling very frequently had much more problems with the humidity and the temperature than, for instance, for me, as maybe a bit too heavy. But still, I cycle to work every day 13 kilometers in the Netherlands. And no problem. Only thing is, here I really was happy with the shower afterwards. Whereas in my own country, I have a shower at the office, but I think it's only used for two people with race bikes, and the other 400 people are not using it. So shower would help, or at least to encourage people. But it's all about not going too fast. Adapt yourself like you are walking. You adapt yourself to the climate. I think with cycling as well. And maybe if you have to go up steep hill, then the e-bikes are of any assistance, but I don't. Yeah, I think it's an argument which is easy to say, but I don't think it's the biggest problem.
Can I add a little bit? Yes. Last few years, I've been traveling the world, and it makes me really happy because you see cycling projects everywhere, especially a lot of cycling projects in Latin America, where of course climate is. Well, the same as here in Singapore, it can be very hot, but those cities aren't withheld by this argument. So maybe from European point of view, you can't really have a good and practical answer, but you can say that other cities with similar challenges as Singapore in terms of climate and in terms of the hills are still growing their numbers in cyclists. So not everybody perceives it as a problem. And through the years, I think you're right there. When you get used to cycling more, you get used to the disadvantages as well. We're used to sitting in a car just doing nothing. So yeah. There are obviously some disadvantages on driving a car as well. So
maybe I can add, because I live in Holland for 7 years, so I know how the European weather is good for cycling. But for people who made this remark, they forgot there is winter there. And winter is so tough that it is not suitable for cycling. And your finger, like, you don't feel your finger, you don't feel your ear. But they still do it. And so weather cannot explain why the Dutch are cycling in the winter. Secondly, I cycle to work in Singapore, and I noticed, compared to the Dutch weather, Singapore is perfect. Why? Because when the time you need to go to work is before 9, and the weather is usually very, very nice, and it's like the summer in European country. And is it nice to cycle in the summer? would you prefer to cycle in the summer or in the winter, right? So in Singapore, you have all year round summer of equivalent summer as Europe. How better you can ask for it? And secondly, when you need to go home is after 6, and the weather is also much nicer. And it's a very nice way to wind down and to de-stress of day's work. And that is my experience.
Very good.
Okay, to address the question about bike share, yes, we made an announcement some time ago, and we had a request for information exercise that we conducted earlier this year. So what we're doing now is looking at all the proposals and evaluating it, and at some point in time, maybe next year early, we will probably hold a tender or something of that sort for a bike sharing system in Singapore. So it's happening lah, akan datang.
Well, then I would like to try to answer the questions both about the temperature, that it's too warm, and also about bike sharing. But I would like to do that in comparison with, together with a short introduction about what we do. The company I work for is Pon, and in particular Pon Bicycle Group, and we are mainly focusing ourselves on mobility, and the bicycle group, of course, on bicycles. These are a couple of the brands that we own, and if you see a lot of international brands, but also big brands who are focusing themselves, particularly on Western Europe, like Gazelle and Kalkoff, which is an e-bike brand. And if you see the next slide, you see that this is what we are doing. This is commuting in its best form. You see here on the right side the king of the Netherlands and his wife on a Gazelle. And you see on the top picture how we also transfer our stuff with a little box on the front and on the back. So this is cycling and how we do that in the Netherlands. We are also specialized in e-bikes. We have two large e-bike brands, also mainly focusing on the European market. But of course, e-bikes is something. If you look at how can you become mobile, but without sweating too much, I thought e-bikes is something what could be something very interesting here for Singapore as well. And then if we look at what kind of solutions or mobility solutions are we offering as Pon. We own Green Wheels, and Green Wheels is one of the largest car sharing platforms in the Netherlands. And in that way, and also, in what Mr. Kaping just told us about having less cars on the road provides more space for bikes. And I think that is something. If we see the next slide, the next one, sorry. Yeah, and that is something which is, I think, very, very important what can be very important for a country like Singapore. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Xue. I'm a passionate cyclist. So I cycle to the venue. I've just had a bike versus car trip here. So a few years ago, I cycled to work every day for about a year. I thought it was quite a cool thing to do because I dressed in colorful jerseys, looked cool on the road. But after that, I stopped because I was afraid I might become a black and white photo after some really close encounter with cars to brush against my elbows, you know. So I think in Singapore, we have the excellent tool to regulate car population. Because for the cyclist, the dedicated cycling lane is truly a blessing. Then, since we have the COE, I have a question particularly for LTA and the URA. Does our government have plan to reduce the car population? Because if we can reduce by 5 to 10%, we will have the space, or we will have more space to pave more bicycle lanes on road for to promote and encourage more cycling in Singapore. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Next question.
Hello. I'm Maria Boy from Institute of Parks and Recreation. Actually, we have strategic plan for cycling, but we have to work closely with the government, and I'm very grateful to URA to give a conference that we had, although it's a small one. But I think for cycling towns, it's not an issue because it can be done. But in the city, it's the difficult one because the street is very, very narrow. I did two cycling sort of trip in the city with planners and other professionals, and they really come back and say, wow, very dangerous, the bus is behind us, and you know, people are not happy that we are cycling on the street. But we did it on Sunday, it's still very difficult. My question is basically, to URA Carping, you did mention only Tampines, the cycling city, but actually the other towns, Pasir Ris, Sembawang, Nisun is also considered a cycling town. And I've done a research in Woodland. It's very safe to cycle in Woodland because it's rather less traffic. I think for LTA, I find that you have many departments and many people working about cycling. But in the end, I can't find the real focus who can I write to because now I know.
We get your now question, Maria. Can we have the next question? Yeah, yeah, thanks.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, mine is very important because I'm doing a mobility conference in February.
We will
February.
Answer your question. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. But this is a
Next question. We'll take five. Yeah. Yeah.
Hi, Andy here. I'm a software and app developer. There's a question I'd like to ask for URA and LTA. You guys talk about PCN connector and stuff. I'd like to know what you guys are going to address secure parking spaces for bikes because a couple years ago my bike got nicked. Just traveling to work, so it kind of be a bummer to go back to home and see your bicycle like MIA got replaced by a market bike. So what are you guys going to do about having a secure, safe parking spaces for bikes or people that commute?
Next question, thanks.
My name is Taiwan. I'm from LoveCycling. I really love cycling. And by the way, I have 10 bikes. That's how a bicycle can pack into a HDB, actually. Okay, so for a serious thing, I wanted and this address to LTA and maybe URA as well. We talk a lot about bike paths and how bike is really good for our country. I'd like to know, and I think maybe it's also good for us to ask ourselves this question. What is our current bicycle ridership right now? And my question is, what is the number or percentage our country is planning to increase it by? I think this will give us a very tangible number or KPI for us to move forward. Because I don't like to do a group therapy and talk about how cycling is nice. I think the fact that it's a Thursday and it's at 3 o'clock, I think we can safely say that everybody here believes that this is the right thing to do. But I think to move forward beyond just recreational, we need to have a very tangible target to aim across. And I do not know of the current ridership. I'm wondering, is there any way the agency is trying to find a number as a reference point and set a percentage so that we can, as a country, we can aim across?
Okay, thanks, we got the question. One more question?
One question at the back, at the top here.
Okay, and then we will get to you because I saw your hand up for a long time. Okay.
Right at the back. You can't see me, I suppose.
Okay.
My name is Faith, I'm from Ministry of Transport, specifically working on private transport strategy, and we kind of started this conversation, and as a result, the Active Mobility Unit was set up at LTA. So we're very much vested in this conversation, and I can say that we're very interested in this, but the reality is we face, like in the documentary you mentioned, it's a political issue. So my question would be to our Dutch friends, actually, because I think in the past, it wasn't always so convenient for cycling, and I think the brief for this event actually mentioned also that cars had a pretty dominant role in society. So what was really that turning point, and how do you, was it engineered, ground up? You know, can you speak a bit more about that? Because it's interesting, in the video you mentioned, even in LA, it's a symbol of inclusion. I mean, in Singapore, it's a symbol of exclusion, you know, aspiration in a way. But even if you remove the quota and you let everyone have a car, it's still a symbol. There's a symbol of a car in many societies. So can you speak about that from the Dutch experience? Thank you so much.
Okay, Lauren here. I'll just follow up with a question. Just now we saw the URI presentation on the BCN. I think it's very good. But the key point is leisure. That's the main key point. Then we saw 700 km throughout the city. That's called intra-town. So there's a vacuum in reality for a real cyclist. When we talk about cyclist mobility, we're talking about cycling to work, to find a living, to find bread and butter on the table. Now, our policy stated very clearly, cyclists must be on the road. So that vacuum has not been touched. So my question to URA and FDA is, why is it so difficult to support a national policy, bicycle is a mode of transport on the road? Because your traffic rules say that it must be on the road. Because don't send us to the pavement. You are just transferring a conflict between bicycle and car to bicycle and pedestrian. I think the proper thing to do, if I can request LTA, to reconsider. I think space is not an excuse. We got 12% road space, the top in the world. I think can be top in the world. I can be confident say that because I saw the article on that. Now 12% is very high. When you talk about user, look at the topic share street space. Why is it the 12% all given to car-centric design? There's no infrastructure built for the bicycle on the road. Zero. Okay, why must the road be so car-centric?
So your question is about, will we be creating more cycle
spaces? Yeah, you look at the PCN, you look at the intra-town.
Okay.
There is nothing on road space, which we are talking about mode of transport. Right? So it's a vacuum there. You just go to on our road. It's a death sentence for any cyclist. It's just how long you survive. It's not whether you can survive. Sorry to say that.
Okay.
If you don't believe me, I challenge Roman, LDA.
We got your question.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Maybe if you sit down, we'll
cycle with us. Then you know when we're going to die.
Yeah.
Okay?
Very
thank you.
Okay. So, okay, just to summarize, many questions for LTA and URA about if there's a target for number of cyclists, if there is initiatives to cut down cars on road, and if there are plans to make more cycling towns, including Woodlands. I can't remember anymore, but for the Dutch experts, I think the very good question is, how do we know we are at a turning point in our mobility culture? Yeah, how do you create that turning, that shift, you know, to change our paradigm for mobility? So please, who wants to take the first question?
Okay, so the question is about the turning point in Holland. Well, actually in the 40s and 50s, we already cycled a lot in Holland. But then the car industry developed, like was shown on the movie as well. And then the city of the streets got stuck with cars, and people started to get frustrated about it because there were a lot of people dying in the streets because of car bicycle accidents. So that's when politicians started to think about how to change the mobility in our country. So that's in short a history of like 20 years. But I think it's important to remember that it takes real political decisions to change the mobility in your country. So if cars are clogging up your city, you can say, well, they have to share the space with the bicycles. You can also say, we can expel the cars from the inner city streets. That's a real political decision, which you cannot take in just 1 or 2 years. But you should really think about that kind of decisions to change your mobility.
No, I think to address some of these issues about numbers and all that, as I mentioned, the mode share now is 1 to 2%. As to how much we can increase, I think it's dependent on a number of factors, you know, how we can roll out the infrastructure, how we can educate people, how we can inculcate a certain culture. So I think we will take it more, you know, in the sense of incrementally rather than have a fixed target, you know, to where we want to work towards to. Then on the question of, you know, whether we can, you know, start on the on-road kind of cycling track rather than off-road, I think there are a number of factors we need to consider, because the priority now is to roll out the bus, you know, the bus system to complement the rail system. I think whatever road space we have, we will want to, you know, use it for the buses first. And the other consideration is the safety aspect, you know, whether people they really know how to, you know, use the, you know, cycle on the road, you know. So there are a few things that we need to consider.
I would like to add something about what was the turning point, because don't get us wrong, we might have a lot of bicycles in the Netherlands, but there are also still a lot of cars in the Netherlands. But I think the main turning point in the Netherlands has been caused by the fact that people feel safe on their bike. And the fact that a pedestrian or a bicycle or a cyclist have a different status in participating in traffic has also caused a lot of, yeah, a good feeling of safety while you are on your bike. And just as an example, if I'm driving in my car, one thing which I will really don't want to hit, that's a cyclist. And first of all, of course, because of the cyclist, but also because I know it doesn't matter if the cyclist was on the wrong position on the street, it's always my mistake. And the same is the situation if a cyclist hits a pedestrian. The cyclist is he's always wrong if he hits it. So the feeling of safety has caused a lot of popularity in the Netherlands. With regards to cycling and being on the street.
That's funny that my Dutch colleagues, first of all, none said that we also had these big demonstrations and protests in the Netherlands in the 70s, like we saw in a movie. We had also big demonstrations by mothers saying child murder, all those cars. And then our government said we have to plan inclusive, so cycling inclusive planning. So we have to take all modes into account and give them, well, enough or equally distribute the space so everyone can benefit from city space. But when it comes to this, what you said about this protected cyclist, it's indeed by law. Cyclists have a status that me as a car driver, I have to explain or to show why the cyclist was wrong and not me when there is an accident. There's really a protected system for the cyclist, but it's true, it helps. But also being a car driver and cyclist myself, so I know how it feels to cycle and be chased by cars. So that also changes your behavior as cyclist and car driver.
Okay, maybe I talk about the car population. I think the crux of the matter is to really provide, to be able to provide alternative means of transport. So whilst we try to emphasize on the train system and also, like what Kaping said, the bus system, the car will always still exist as an alternative mode of transportation, but our aim really is to promote the other two and also other active modes of transportation so that people will start choosing these other modes instead of automatically going to their cars. And also we have to start developing the other active modes much better, rolling out the infrastructure before we can actually have more people convert from their cars to the active modes.
So I think, how about time? I think we're done, eh? Yeah, I smell the food also. And I see...
if you can talk to these people.
I see
they will
a
be
lot
outside.
Of people that still have questions. I saw eager joyrider there with the hands in the air, and Raymond, of course. I think it's time for food and drinks. These guys will be there, definitely there to answer all your questions, all of them. So I want to thank you all.
Thank you.
Limin, especially you. my partner in crime.
And thanks to Susan for being such a great partner and fun partner for this whole collaboration. We'd like to thank all the panelists and all of you, invite you to the networking reception after this. But we first will be giving a small token of appreciation.
Definitely.
To all our panelists. Where are the tokens?
Thank you. We would like to show our appreciation to both Limin, Susan, as well as our panelists. And we will have a photo-taking session in a while. Could I also invite the Executive Director of the Centre for Liveable Cities, Mr. Khoo Teng Chai, as well as His Excellency Jacques Werner, the Ambassador, down on stage.